the PCT off. So I created a very sketchy document on Gobi. You can fetch it and fill it with everything you want. There is also this IRT channel for people watching this remotely if you want to participate. Okay, so maybe we can do a quick round table if there are not too many of us. Yeah. Okay, we'll see. So, well, it's supposed to be open discussion, so I won't say much. So I would like first to collect your impression on publicity in Debian in general, and if you have some criticism and ideas.
Yes, no, I was just focusing on the brand and the marketing of it, where you showed the newsletter and it all looks very, not boring, but it doesn't look very appealing. So nothing seems consistent in the way of branding, you know? So I was thinking if you sort of upmarket, make that a bit more upmarket and, you know, people will focus on that and it'll become more one than all over.
Yeah, so we would need some people to show us how to do it.
Absolutely, like artwork, yeah.
Okay.
I think it's more coming up with like a visual idea and concept.
Okay.
And just giving it more of a branding and more of a unity is probably the correct word.
So Tammy's part of our designer team for DevCon 16 for next year. And both of us are very new to Debian at large. So what we've learned so far is there's this beautiful thing about Debian that everybody can contribute and change things. You know, now we're talking about the visual identity, like this role to make it their own. But at the same time, we strongly feel that there also needs to be a brand that's wider than just this role. It's the whole layout and everything. And we're stuck on how to get it both ways.
Because the idea is that we can understand why it would just be sort of white background with the copy and whatever, because it relates to the coding world, you know, and it relates to developers in that respect. But it doesn't stand out very well. And I think if you had a newsletter that stood out a little bit more. I'm talking to him. If it stood out a little bit more, you know, then I think you'd get more people interested in it because it doesn't look boring, for lack of a better word. It doesn't look appealing, at the end of the day. That's just my little bit of crit from a designer eye, put it that way. So, because when I see a brand, then I think, okay, we need to get this going, you know, we've got to get a proper identity going, you know, it's great for marketing, you could go to sponsors, you know, things like that. So that's my two cents.
So I just wanted to point out, so the swirl, there was a trademark, birds of a feather, two trademark birds of feathers yesterday, or day before. And we were talking about the notion that the swirl is being trademarked.
Okay.
So because it would be a trademark, you wouldn't be able to modify the swirl.
Yeah.
Right?
Definitely.
So there's a lot of existing, you know, like the Linux Mint logo, one derivation of that logo is a swirl with a Mint logo embedded on the center of the swirl. And there are some other derivatives that have been created, right, like that. And what happens in trademark law, and I'm not a lawyer, so I'll just preface all following comments with that. But what happens in trademark law whenever you have a derivation of a logo that you trademark is that it loses its distinctive indication of source, which is a requirement for being a trademark. And so if you allow people to modify that mark, then you run the risk of losing that as
a
passes.
I don't think that's really needed here, though. I think, I mean, this is just a Debian newsletter, so
understood.
It just needs to have, at the moment, in the newsletter I sent out, there is no Debian logo at all, but it is an official Debian thing, so there's no
understood.
There's no legal problem about having it. I mean, the reason at the moment is just the historical thing that Debian developer type people are allergic to HTML email at all, so they're just sending a plain text format email with no, as you say, no markup, no branding, anything. And maybe that's something that should be at least an option, possibly.
Yeah, it's not an either or.
Back to the trademark thing.
I was just trying to identify that as a risk that we need to stay away from modifications of the logos if we're going to.
But also many trademark policies allow composition of the original logo with another
with
content.
Other things, yeah. Provided they don't.
Can we? I think this is off topic here. A bit off topic, I'm sorry. Yeah. I would like to ask people here, when you are following what's going on in Debian, what is your preferred way of knowing what's going on? You read Planet, you follow Twitter, you read Debian Project News?
I read things on Twitter because it shows up in my news feed. I don't read emails usually because I get so many different things, and it's really common for people to not read newsletters or lists.
Is somebody here reading usually Debian Project News?
Well, I read it, but together with Planet.
The long time I did read it carefully every time. I think in recent periods there's been quite often duplication between the newsletter content and previous announcements on Debian Devel Announce. So people who are already in the project, by the time you get the newsletter, it tends to be or things that are often is kind of familiar, which is a bit not ideal. But still, there's a lot of people who don't read the other messages. So I think there'll be an audience for the newsletter certainly.
I'm an email reader, but when I read the email, I don't get the subject line. If the subject line doesn't get my attention right away, I don't read it. And so rather than have a large newsletter with lots and lots of things in it, and subject line that says Debian newsletter, it might be better to have more newsletters with the subject line telling more of what's inside.
But you cannot say much in subject line, and besides keywords maybe for major interesting topics within the letter. Right?
Yes, that's what
so
I'm saying.
Newsletter, new DPL, something like really kind of major points.
Tweets are 140 characters. So that's the subject line.
There we go. Put the number.
Send me an email with 140 characters in the subject, I'm not going to read it. Mm-hmm.
Maybe if the first couple letters are mad up.
Mad D star.
Is that your filter?
I have a question. When we talk about specifically how people consume information, it seems to me that there's two different groups of people that we're talking about. There's Debian reach for Debian people, that is, how do we communicate internally? And then there's Debian reach out to people who are not currently part of the Debian project that might like to join or use Debian or something. And that seems to me like it has a different flavor to it. Like, you're not going to reach the second group of people at all with a newsletter. On the other hand, you might be more able to like actually use HTML mail for something that you're reaching out to the general public with, without getting tons of like nasty grams from DDs. So, when we talk about publicity, which of those are we more talking about?
It's a mix of all of them, really. That's what the team handles, is everything from internal communication to external people who aren't involved in Debian or necessarily even know that.
It's feasible to send both HTML and text.
Right? Sure.
Yeah, but you might also want different newsletters altogether for different audiences.
Yeah.
I mean, when we're announcing that we've, we do already have this. I mean, that we do have different types of announcements that go to different groups of people.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a kind of spectrum of grayness rather than just in or out people, because even people who are project members, actually, some of them don't necessarily read all other possible sources of Debian information, so there are communication needs there. But as you come out, there are people who make occasional, maybe they are in the Debian community, but that means that they occasionally get a package from testing and occasionally make bug reports or whatever. And then there are people who are just very occasional, I mean, using Debian the whole time or occasionally using Debian and so on, who have different needs.
But what I mean is just the in the same.
It's going to be interesting to them. It's clearly different depending on which part they're in.
Sure. But I thought just the question is how to present, how to make that newsletter appealing to the audience, right? For Debianoids, let's put it, it's text, right? For general audience, it better be flashy, indeed. So there should be somewhat nice background and maybe layout. And you could send in the same email, in the same email with HTML and text together. And Debianoids will just read the text version and the others, they'll get flashy HTML.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So it should work. That's how it works, I believe, right? In many domains, examples. What could be the flashy layout and background? That's another question.
I feel like if you're trying to reach people outside of the insiders of Debian, it's not just the flashiness of the website, but you need an entire marketing strategy, which includes social media, which includes Twitter, Pinterest, Facebook, you know, choose a few, and the wording, the way, the language that you speak, the acronyms that you use. Your entire language is targeted towards the benefits to the end user as opposed to the technical prowess of what you're doing. It's an entirely different angle.
What is happening now with Debian Twitter?
Debian officially doesn't have Twitter.
Retweets a
That's
lot of
right.
stuff.
But do is Debian reserved for Debian on
it
Twitter,
is in
right?
use.
Okay. But it's there, at least we have it, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So who has access to tweets? So will you listen to all the tweets which are directed at you and then redistribute them, or?
At the moment we have a we have neither a policy nor, well, we do have somewhat of a workflow, but it's not working very well. So policy, there's no policy. No, there is a policy. It is, if you want access and you want to help out, then we will gladly give you access and help out. And if you see something that's worth you retweeting, then go and retweet it. And when there's original content, then so far on the publicity channel, there has been propositions and then acknowledgements by another person, so the deal has been I want to write these 140 characters, and then if somebody says, yeah, that's okay, then that's enough, and then it goes out on Identica, and it goes out on Twitter, whenever people have access to it. And obviously, this sucks a lot, because we don't have a way to schedule tweets, we don't have any form of social media, really. I mean, it's Identica, or it doesn't matter, we don't have a way of really just publishing the same information to multiple networks. We don't have a way to draft online things. And I mean, Hootsuite or all these other things would be possibilities for us, except of course they only work on Twitter. And since we don't officially have a Twitter account, it's of no use to us. So what a lot of us really would like to have, I think, is some sort of management system whereby we can add messages and then they sort of like get propagated to all the networks. And
it's just I'm not much into social media, but there are such systems, I bet, at this age, right? So theoretically, it's just the question of choosing one.
I don't think we found any so far.
There is that one that Lounge of them. Yeah,
you could mention the constraint is also to find something that's free and
yeah.
So on.
The problem with that that one was that it was bidirectional, I think.
It was bidirectional and didn't do any of that stuff like, you know, hashtags and it's at here and it's another thing there and whatever. So, it's not ideal, but I think it could be done, and I think Laura is interested in working on it, but it's just not really a priority.
But I think everyone agrees in principle that we should have some, that we should have the same messages pushed out to different social networks, and that we should have the ability to plan some tweets and equivalents in advance and update things if there's something urgent, but otherwise you can have some stack ready to go out in different days. So
this does tie in, and I don't want to jump, maybe you have this for later on, but it does tie into the bigger picture. At the moment, by the time that we have drafted, acknowledged, and finally posted a piece of information on Twitter, it's like we're like 14 hours later. So like, the world knew about Debian Stable release 14 hours before we posted, we finally ended up posting the tweet. And that's, in my opinion, a problem in the sense that we are not regarded as the marketing team.
Because again,
this
tweet should have been sitting ready and with...
It should have been A, sitting ready, and B, we need to get the information first.
Person just doing the tweets thing, or doing the...
Ah, we have computers. We just need to find the computer. We need to do that.
We need to make sure that the information collects with us, and that we are the ones that control, if possible, control the representation to the outside world. So that, no, not somebody from the release team tweets that we now have a stable... I mean, let them... somewhat could be coordinated. But we should know that this happens in advance. It always comes as a surprise when we say something. So I don't really know how to solve that, but I would say that if we the more organized and the more present we as a team become, the more we're going to be in the minds of people, and they're going to hopefully come to us and speak with us before doing so. But not if we don't react. So it's a hard call. It's a hard thing to solve with volunteer.
Are there people already volunteering for this kind of task?
I'm doing it right now, but as I said, I think I'm not entirely sure that it makes a lot of sense to now collect volunteers for the social networks and volunteers for the project news and volunteers. I mean, I think the project news are already working very well. You guys managed to revive them after a long out time, and it's going. It's a lot of work for some few people. I'm very aware of that. But
also these things should be coordinated. It's not just a matter of having a silo of people who do social media and a silo of people who do the project news or whatever. I mean, again, for something like the release, clearly it should be all these messages written in coordination together from the press release to the tweets.
Essentially what we should have, or what I'm sorry.
That's kind of nicely what
it's it is kind of happening, but again, it's not. I mean, in terms of when people are saying collecting volunteers and so on, again, you want everyone to be part of a team with people doing particular jobs in that, not building a big team who are going to come up with a great plan for social media but ignore everything else.
One thing that that we floated a couple of times now was sort of any news, anything relevant comes in and gets a record, like a file in Git or a ticket on RT or whatever it is.
That sounds like a lot of manual work if you're going to use Git or RT.
Okay,
some solution.
An email thread, let's say for us. That's easy.
Well, no, the point was that this is this becomes an entity with some sort of workflow attached to it, and we have translation infrastructure, so you could actually abuse that to translate from EN announcement to EN tweet, and sort of keep it all in there, which is all optional, and so then you have this thing sitting there in the queue, and it's like, you know, this is a news item worthy of publishing, and it's tagged Project News, Twitter, and so on, and so then when the person that does Twitter comes on, they can just simply say, what are the news items, and maybe they already translated, or I do that myself, and then I think it's going to be rather trivial to just simply say, okay, tweet all of it, because that's a Python script of 5 lines. So that's one possible way of going about it. It is a lot of manual work, but we're doing more manual work at the moment.
I think the other thing that's a problem in the way things are currently working in terms of making the publicity output more relevant is that very few things that are being announced are actually surprises that suddenly happened. Like, we're not announcing there was suddenly an earthquake somewhere, Palestine, whatever it is. It's things we could have known in advance and had everything written. But at the moment, obviously, the culture in Debian is that each individual team pushes out their own announcement when they're ready. And it's extremely rare to coordinate that in advance to get an announcement that could then be put out to external audience at the same time, for example. So if you're really not following anything in Debian at all, then that doesn't matter. But the people who are kind of halfway in between, or which includes lots of the journalists, actually, they might be, they want the external announcement in a way, but they also read Debian Devel announce. And by the time we've got something ready, they've already seen the Devel announce post and kind of written, got some confused idea of what's going on a long time before. I don't know if it's realistic to ask teams to hold things back, but at least they could be asked to inform them a bit earlier before they've done their own announcement, maybe.
Or maybe you gather, you sort of gather what you need and then sync it, you know, and then post it all at one time. So you get, you know, you have a sort of certain time that you're going to do those posts, and you say, okay, this time those posts are going to go out. You know, then you can start putting in your stuff and then sync it like that. Just as a...
I think that's a good word for it. The question is the practical or social thing of getting the volunteers, in particular other Debian teams, to make the effort to cooperate with that.
So I do this at work. It's my little context for what I'm going to say, but it's really not that hard. Things that we do is, you know, we have schedules, and people pull things in on schedules. One of the really common things we do, because teams do manage their own stuff, is we just retweet things other people say, and we give each other a heads up. So, you know, if you have a team that's officially making some set of announcements, and you have other teams that are making announcements, like, the communication pattern here isn't that hard, especially if one person is willing to say, like, hey, I'm going to be the person who remembers to tell them.
But isn't that too much PT then?
What do you mean?
Like, isn't that, if someone is going to be having to tell them each time, do you assign one person to do that?
I don't think you need to assign someone, I think.
Like, I think it needs
to be a discussion.
Yeah,
it's dedicated to.
Exactly.
Okay.
I don't think it's onerous to ask somebody to, like, post a link to someone on IRC. I do that all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for fun.
And it doesn't even have to be the same person from the team every time, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's not like we don't need to ask the release team to designate a publicity person, just, hey guys, when Jesse's gonna unfreeze, like, can you just give us a heads up? Like, it's not like this happens very often and it's going to be so burdensome. We're not, like, arch. We don't do a release every 15 seconds. Like, we should be able to coordinate this.
It's pretty well coordinated for Jesse, I think.
Yeah. But even for the smaller things, right? Like, we don't...
Right.
How many announcements do we have that are interesting enough to be noteworthy to the general public in a given year? 5, 10, 20?
But these are also not actually they're informative and useful information, but not necessarily interesting for people in terms of reading content.
Right,
yeah.
Like,
seeing the list of packages that have been updated in the point release is not really something you're going to say, oh, I better read that email.
Right.
It's
so, I mean,
fun, unless it's your job.
A point release, major releases,
conferences, events, right? Like mini, DevConf, DevConf related stuff, job postings, anything we got through, like the Debian signing some, like the Debian agreement coming to some new thing with some company, or like getting a sponsorship. These are all great things, but there's not that many of them. So like I would worry more about the burden we were asking teams if we were doing hundreds of these. And then I'd say, okay, we really need to like figure out some more formal process of coordination.
From somebody outside of Debian, I was really interested in the dev day idea. I do think it needs to be translated in a way that, like, why would the person on the street be interested in it? So what makes an ARM so fascinating? I'm really into open hardware because of what I think it could do. It can, you could hack your own beer brewing station at home or something. You know, like put it into context in something that people who really don't care about software could understand, or about computers in general could understand. Which I guess would take about an hour's work. Maybe not the day of day, but maybe twice a week or once a week. And I would say, if I know that I'm not going to mess up too bad, yeah, I would volunteer for that.
Okay.
So, we'd probably need a couple of test runs to see if I mess it up.
Do you have any place on your site or your wiki where people can contribute case studies, like she was talking about, of how did I use Debian to do something? And because, you know, in the commercial world, this is how you sell services and stuff, is through case studies. So that when... So, for example, if you have case studies from banks, when a bank comes along and looks for a solution, they see that other people have used that, and therefore they would be willing to use it too.
So we have a section on the website listing the different companies or institutions using Debian. I don't remember exactly the URL.
But is it still maintained?
Yes.
Like, is it
yes.
But case studies are a little bit lower in depth than that. They say how they used it and how it saved them money or how it improved them, you know, that type of thing. Not just that they used it.
But it's easy enough to
include that information.
Yes, we could use this.
You could contact those companies.
Already we have users and try to contact them to like small, do some small interviews, and that's a good idea.
But it also the more open to the community, like she was talking about, the interesting ones like the beer brewing station and things like that. I mean, the Raspberry Pi people are very good at doing this, and that attracts a lot of people coming to their site just to see what people are doing, the strange things, which also creates news articles because the news people are interested in that too.
Like, this is very powerful, not only on the web, like also if you think about a booth at an exhibition, for example, for the OpenStreetMap project. We did a lot of our demos, like just have any kind of map, a public transport map, a printed map, or we had a live demo of every edit happening in the world on a big screen, something like that. I mean, then people can see what they can use, and this is really powerful.
Interesting cases when Debian is a case study, pretty much. Whenever there is a publication which analyzes different distributions or uses Debian as representative, let's say, community in open source. There was this European report on open source benefits, right, a few years back by Bosch. It's really interesting read, right, because Debian was chosen to be the kind of project to analyze. And there were quite a few of those, I believe.
So if I want to find that report, can I just do a web search for EU report on open source?
And GOSH, G-H-O-S-H. But that's been a few years back.
It's okay, it's a stop.
Then that lady of the book, which was given away this morning on Anonymous, for her first book, I believe, was also a study of open source, and it was largely around Debian. I've forgotten her name.
Gabrielle.
Right, I believe her first one, she's an anthropologist.
Yes, she's spoken at DevConf before.
She's worked at DevConf before.
Right.
Her first book includes a chapter on Debian, is it?
I think so.
Yes,
I
think
so.
But pretty much those were Debian is kind of, you know, representative open source project out there.
I volunteer to do that once a week.
Okay.
And then
if
I can publish the information I like with the text based form as a backup. And then we can just play.
Absolutely.
And if you don't like it, we can.
That's cool.
Because then we can also do it as many of us.
Absolutely.
But I mean, that's also stuff that you would like, apart from being archived on the email list, it ought to be archived somewhere on the website as a friendly section as well.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
I mean, yeah, if you could, if the, at the moment it's basically just a list of links of organizations, which is not very.
No, I'm thinking of a blog.
So exactly, this would be nice,
a
little
article. Picture article,
yeah,
with a permalink, which is available for use for anyone else. Like, the reason why I'm, so my intentions are not entirely altruistic, apart from that I want to learn more about Debian. We're trying to source sponsors in South Africa that use Debian, and this is a great way to build that for this, and also this content for the DevCon 16 website, so you can pull traffic out.
Next topic, so I did a section about the Debian project news. We need more volunteers for that. Difficult to keep up with the schedule, and so if we take too long to prepare an issue, then the news are not news anymore. So we need more people to. Help us to publish this much faster. So if you are interested, I can show you anytime what is our workflow and how to contribute to this. It's quite easy, and it's very, very nice when there are several people working on this at about the same time. You can coordinate on IRC and things like that. It can be fun. So then what do we have? We have events and the idea of virtual event box. So can we have this?
That's pretty much just a summary of what came out of this morning question of mine, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we compiled, if you go to that wiki page, we've compiled ideas for possible materials which will accompany an event box, which might not be the physical event box which we distribute, but it's a convenient package, maybe even Debian package, right, which comes with materials. Oh, I want to present Debian at this event. There is nobody near with those materials, but I could print them out, either at local publishers or whatever local resources you have, or maybe even order from online, but you have at least all the materials and the ideas how to establish, let's say, exhibit book, right? Because it's also not trivial, especially if you go and do it first time, there might be good ideas how to kind of set it up and attract attention to your book. So if you have any ideas, especially cool ideas, right, about that, that's a wiki page for it to contribute to. And from there, we'll probably go with reviving some version control system repository, probably Git, with materials for that occasion, because we had CVS, we still have it, CVS for Trifold. Some were probably artwork leaps as well. Well, we have it online, of course, but we don't have anything central where you just clone these and you have all the materials you need.
It's almost like a marketing material file.
Pretty much, yeah.
So you've got your sticker, you've got your presentations, you've maybe got your slides and the templates, things like that.
And virtual books and live CD and all these kind of things.
Or you can buy it or you can download it or something like that,
mm-hmm.
and then use it at whatever function you're at.
That's right.
Which then goes back to the whole branding and marketing idea again, and giving it an identity and a face, which would go back to his question of the trademark, where then you would have to go, okay, well, then we have to relook at everything and then see what are we going to do, what identity are we all going to agree on, and then trademark that and use it for all the marketing. So that's...
Well, identity we have this role, right? That's the, you know, the major thing. If we want to theme them all up, that's another kind of, we could, for every release we have a new theme, right? Maybe we would be able to, or multiple, well, we have a winner usually, right? A winner.
I don't think we're going to get anywhere other than just the swirl. There is an agreed on font, but I'm not sure if it's going to be available. That's about as tame as you're going
to
get these guys.
Yeah, no, but I'm saying, like, if you're going to do what he's suggesting, where you have a box, where if he's got a function happening wherever, and he wants to represent Debian and bring that into it, how can he get that stuff, and how can it be accessible? And I think from there you've got to go, okay, well, what are you looking at, you know? If that is going to be universal, and people wanting to download it and use it, or get it sent to them as a package,
you
know?
Maybe take this offline.
So,
I would like to take advantage that we have Andrew here. I'm very sorry for asking you a direct question. In Linux Weekly News, this seems to pick up very well when you report about what's happening in Debian. What are you following for getting information about Debian? Mailing list?
I can only speak for myself.
Yeah, well.
But I probably get the majority of information from the Planet feed. That's just me. I know that our other two full-time writers, I think, maybe would shift more towards the mailing lists. But I'm not 100%. I mean, I read the mailing lists as well. So, I think I follow the Twitter account, but I don't ever look at it, just for signal for noise reasons. Most from other people, not from the Debian account. I don't know, that answer is going to be kind of peculiar to the sorts of stuff that we cover, though, which tends to be focused on what individual developers are working on. So I don't know if that's helpful or not, but that's my reply.
Okay, thank you.
Is there anything that you would like to know about what's going on in Debian that's not easy to get at the moment? I mean, apart from inside secrets or a generic topic, I mean, if we were going to invest in some more publicity effort.
I think I've got a quick answer to that. I might be able to come up with something with some stewing time. So I don't think of Debian as a project that it's hard to get information about, I guess.
Yeah.
There are projects like that.
You might think about ways of measuring how effective your publicity is. If you put in different URLs for different streams and feeds, and when people read that, come back and click on that, and count the number of clicks.
I have tried to do that, but given privacy laws and so on, I tried doing that with a Debian blog, but we have anonymized logs. So I cannot really get accurate stats of what's going on. I only can get more or less referrals. But given that I don't have IP information of where people is coming from, the country, we can't really have any way. We don't have any accurate way of doing that without inviting people's privacy.
Well,
it's a difficult problem.
I would just say that if you put out, to one group, a URL pointing to one page, and all you're doing is counting how many times that page is accessed with that URL, that's a pretty non-invasive type of thing. You're not capturing anybody's name or personal information. You're just saying, I sent out this piece of information with this URL, how effective was it at bringing back people to visit this page?
I agree about that.
Yeah.
I would love doing something like that, just not on the Debian blog or the tweets. I would love doing that with the Debian website. Because I am sure some pages have never accessed. Nobody's visiting them. But probably requires somebody doing that and finding the best, not interesting way for the information. There are a lot of positions.
So we have 5 minutes left. So comments? Okay, so we could stop here.
If we have 5 minutes, do you want to wrap up and just sort of like summarize what we've learned, what we take from this, and whether we're better off now than we were 45 minutes before?
And maybe also if people who are here haven't, probably have some interest, many of the people here may have some interest and not all of them are yet involved, so maybe what they should do if they want to carry on involvement after this discussion.
What to say. So, maybe there are people on IRC or something?
No, I have a question, just a general question with regards to publishing of Debian and the apparent wish to increase its the types of users, who are the types of users that you're interested in? Are they technical people? Are they people who currently use Windows and are looking to kind of like switch to Linux, and then we want to be the Linux version of choice? Or what kind of users or new users are we looking to get?
That's the problem. I want them all.
Yeah, because again,
exactly. Yeah, with Debian especially, it's hard to formalize.
Well, can I give a step for what I want? So obviously you want to keep the existing Debian community happy.
Yeah.
So these are the Debian contributors who's hardline geeks.
Mm-hmm.
And then my next catchment, who I would like to reach with this Debian a week, is people who are curious about making things or even about buying kits, even if they don't want to have them at home yet. So that could be anybody from someone who wants to make cheese, someone who wants to do an auto crochet, so those kind of people. So they might not have an interest in computers in general, but they do know that computers can make them, help them do stuff.
Mm.
That's fine. So I'm not particularly interested in people who convert their desktop computers to Linux or Ubuntu. Just, I don't see how that actually adds value, because I don't think they know the difference between the two. And I think from there you need to, if that's what you want to do, and I may be wrong, then I think you need to go to corporates or somebody who can roll those things out. Because people who buy, when I buy a computer, I just expect it to open it up, switch it on, go on the internet. I don't care how it does that, which is bad, but as an entry level, if that's where you want me to get interested in, I'll never become interested.
And what if you can't do that? What if you want to switch to Linux, and then you've got the CD or the USB drive, and you stick it in, you try and boot, you try and install, and you've got no wireless connection? No internet. Or your touchscreen doesn't work. You've got a new laptop and you've got no touchscreen support, and you're thinking. Okay.
So how do you get to? So I guess that sort of user will have some other way of finding. If I don't have somebody next to me helping me, I go into the internet or some other device and search how do I.
Yeah, but I would imagine new users who aren't tech savvy, that they would maybe have a desire to switch to Linux, and they would kind of like, okay, what is the best Linux distro I should use? And a lot of the sites they will find will recommend Ubuntu or something else.
Need to
and
this discussion.
Well, you can take it outside.
Yeah, but,
Okay, so all people interested in should join the Debian Publicity IRC channel or send an email to the Debian Publicity mailing list, and we'll happily make new things together to improve the Debian. Thank you.